Nunca vou esquecer ele.
Prezados presentes, podemos começar? Prezados, boa noite. Meu nome é Luciana. Boa noite, boa tarde, né? Perdi um pouco a noção do tempo. Meu nome é Luciana Marisa, eu sou uma das organizadoras do colóquio. Sejam muito bem-vindos. Em nome de toda a comissão organizadora, eu desejo a vocês uma ótima sexta edição do nosso colóquio internacional de letramento e cultura escrita. Gostaria de convidar para compor a nossa mesa solene de abertura a digníssima diretora da Faculdade de Educação, professora Juliane Correia. A prezada coordenadora da pós, professora Maria de Fátima Cardoso Gomes. A prezada diretora do Centro de Alfabetização, Leitura e Escrita, CEALE, professora Valéria Rezende. E o organizador do nosso sexto colóquio, o prezado professor Gilcinei Teodoro Carvalho. Passo agora a palavra para a prezada professora Juliana Correia.
Bom dia. Bom dia, boa tarde, boa noite, porque nós estamos assim, não é? Com certeza tem pessoas em percurso chegando, né? Ainda pessoas ainda chegando, ainda estão lá embaixo chegando, e nós aqui. É, eu fiquei refletindo um pouco desse momento, né, do colóquio, do sexto colóquio, e da gente estarmos aqui todos presentes no domingo. Exatamente porque é algo muito precioso. E precioso porque vem ocupando a equipe já há um bom tempo, né, Gil? Trabalhando, investindo com cuidado, com carinho. Precioso porque tem uma equipe lá preparando algumas guloseimas, né? Então, assim, é um momento muito precioso para todos nós, né? Um momento muito caro, porque é algo que nós já temos uma tradição, nós já estamos no sexto colóquio, né? É um colóquio internacional que nós já temos parceiros antigos que sempre estão aqui compartilhando conosco essa caminhada, onde nós temos uma equipe extremamente efetiva que há muitos anos investe muito do seu trabalho na construção desse campo de saber, de conhecimento, e de participantes que sempre estão conosco, sejam de outras instituições próximas ou aqui do nosso contexto nacional também. Então, eu acredito que esse investimento de estarmos aqui mostra o valor desse trabalho, desta temática, e todo o cuidado que nossa Faculdade de Educação fizemos para recebê-los mostra o quanto também todos que aqui estão são muito preciosos para nós. Muito obrigada pela presença de todos. Desejo um excelente colóquio ao longo desses dias. À medida do possível, vou ver o que eu consigo participar. E agradeço a mesa aqui presente por todo o investimento e por todo o trabalho. Então, desejo muito sucesso e podem contar conosco que estamos à disposição para o que for necessário ao longo desses dias. Muito obrigada.
Passo agora a palavra para a professora Maria de Fátima Cardoso Gomes.
Boa tarde a todos. Obrigada pela presença. Em nome do Programa de Pós-Graduação em Educação, Conhecimento e Inclusão Social, eu saúdo a todos e desejo que nós todos tenhamos uma rica semana de troca de experiências, de saberes, conhecimentos entre diferentes culturas que aqui estão. Né? E com dois sentimentos opostos, vamos dizer assim, que eu saúdo a todos, né? Um sentimento de alegria, porque estamos aqui, podemos realizar esse sexto colóquio, e um sentimento de um pouco de tristeza pela ausência do Brian, a quem nós vamos fazer uma homenagem, com certeza, porque ele foi a pessoa, Brian Street, not Brian Morgan, Brian Street, foi a pessoa que, de fato, pensou esse colóquio junto conosco pela primeira vez. E conseguimos fazer 5 colóquios com a presença dele. Esse 6º, ele está presente em nossos corações, né? Então, desejo a todos nós uma semana muito, muito proveitosa de trabalho conjunto. Obrigada.
Passo agora a palavra para a professora Valéria Rezende.
Bom, gente, boa tarde a todos e a todas. Em nome do CEALI, eu gostaria de dar as boas-vindas, né, aos participantes aí do 6º Colóquio Internacional sobre Letramento e Cultura Escrita. Eu também gostaria de lembrar, né, e de homenagear 2 professores que foram muito importantes, né, para as discussões teóricas, né, dos referidos aí, das edições, né, do colóquio, né, e que, infelizmente, não estão mais entre nós, que é a professora Marildes Marinho e o professor Brian Street, que a Mafá lembrou muito bem. E a gente vai ter uma homenagem, né, Gil, ao especial hoje para o Brian Street. Outro ponto que eu gostaria de ressaltar diz respeito à relevância, né, do tema do 6º colóquio. O tema, né, relações entre linguagem e poder em contextos educacionais, no momento em que as diretrizes do governo federal, né, brasileiro, tem negado toda essa discussão sobre letramentos sociais e sobre diversidade, né, de uma forma geral. Aí eu queria só ressaltar, né, exemplificar, com relação à última versão da BNCC, da Base Nacional Comum Curricular, em que o termo letramento, né, foi subtraído desse documento. Termo, né, relacionada a letramento, às práticas sociais de leitura e de escrita, presentes na primeira e segunda versões. Então, eu acho que é um momento importante, né, de debate, de identificação de lacunas na pesquisa, como está colocado lá como um dos objetivos também desse 6º colóquio, e um momento das universidades marcarem essa posição teórica, metodológica e ideológica. Então, eu acho que é um encontro muito importante, um momento importante aí essa discussão. Por fim, eu gostaria de parabenizar os organizadores, né, todos os organizadores aí do colóquio, e eu vou só citar, né, o Gil Cinei Carvalho, dar os parabéns, a Lalu, que não está aqui fisicamente, né, presente fisicamente, mas com certeza ela está acompanhando tudo, né, à distância, e sempre nos apoiando. Então, eu desejo a todos um ótimo colóquio e um ótimo domingo para todos. Muito obrigada.
Passo a palavra ao professor Jusinei Teodoro Carvalho.
Digníssima diretora da Faculdade de Educação, professora Juliana Correia, prezada coordenadora do programa de pós-graduação daqui da Faculdade de Educação, professora Maria de Fátima Gomes, nossa querida Mafá, prezada diretora do CEALE, Centro de Alfabetização, Leitura e Escrita, professora Valéria Rezende, prezados convidados das diversas instituições, prezados participantes de diversos pontos do Brasil, prezados colegas professores e pesquisadores, prezados alunos de pós-graduação e de graduação, bem-vindos todos à Faculdade de Educação da UFMG, à UFMG, a Belo Horizonte, a Minas Gerais, ao Brasil, não necessariamente nessa ordem. Então, sejam todos muito bem-vindos. Em primeiro lugar, nosso agradecimento a todos vocês. Obrigado por estar aqui conosco hoje, nessa 6ª edição do Colóquio Internacional sobre Letramento e Cultura Escrita. Como importante sinalizador de leitura, o rótulo, a forma de nomear, traz algumas indicações que devem ser brevemente destacadas. A cronologia, 6ª edição, revela a história de um encontro, de uma conversa, que teve início em 2007 e passou a se constituir como um evento bianual. Uma caminhada de uma década que, embora possa numericamente expressar uma pequena trajetória, expressa muito em termos simbólicos e intelectuais. Talvez o principal simbolismo seja exatamente esse desejo de continuidade e esse esforço de permanência, principalmente quando a situação é adversa. Nomear esse evento acadêmico como colóquio tem suas intencionalidades. No estado de dicionário, o termo colóquio indica uma conversação de caráter informal. Assim escreve Aurélio: colóquio, substantivo masculino, conversação ou palestra entre duas ou mais pessoas. Veja que estamos em vantagem aqui nessa nossa conversação. Reunião de pessoas gabaritadas em que se debate determinado assunto. Por derivação, pode indicar também um evento acadêmico que ocorre geralmente nas universidades. Em um colóquio acadêmico, se produzem debates. Termino a citação. Exatamente a ideia de conversação e de debate é que nos move nesse evento acadêmico e, portanto, minimiza talvez o peso de palavras como congresso, destacando a natureza do diálogo e da interação mais aberta e flexível que demarca uma conversação. Por essa razão, estimulamos, no desenho desse encontro, a aproximação das pessoas em painéis que possam fomentar debates, conversas, de preferência as infinitas conversas que se estendem pelos corredores e por outros espaços e tempos. Destacando, então, a palavra debate, desde a primeira edição, estamos em um constante colóquio a conversar sobre os conceitos de letramento e de cultura escrita, tentando ampliar as nossas concepções e entender as várias dimensões históricas, sociais, linguísticas, cognitivas, pedagógicas, novamente, não necessariamente nessa ordem, presentes nas práticas de leitura e de escrita. O debate dessa sexta edição do colóquio tematiza as relações entre linguagem e poder nos contextos educacionais e, seguramente, é motivador o suficiente para promover reflexões que permitam construir pontos de vista mais variados sobre estudos nesse campo de conhecimento. Ao provocar uma conversa sobre as relações entre linguagem e poder, não poderíamos deixar de expressar o componente político que dimensiona nossas ações e indicar que a concretização desse colóquio é fundamentalmente uma ação de posicionamento em defesa da continuidade de debates produtivos e autênticos que devem ser marca constante das instituições de ensino. Por isso, saudamos com imensa alegria a resposta positiva que demonstraram ao aceitar a proposta de continuidade desse colóquio, especialmente em um momento em que somos pressionados a adiar nossos projetos e a limitar nossas conversas. Um agradecimento especial aos nossos colegas de outros programas, do Programa de Estudos Linguísticos da Faculdade de Letras da UFMG, aqui representado pela professora Andréia Matos e também pela professora Miriam Jorge, aos colegas do Programa de Pós-Graduação em Letras da PUC Minas, aqui representados nas pessoas de Juliana Assis e Jane Quintiliano, e do Programa de Pós-Graduação em Linguística Aplicada da Unicamp, aqui representado pela professora Raquel Fiad. As conversas certamente exigem parcerias. Além desses colegas, sempre parceiros, expressamos também o agradecimento à FAPEMIG e à CAPES, que com o auxílio permitiram a existência do trabalho de tradução. Que tenhamos boas conversas e, principalmente, que continuemos nossa ação política de debater sobre as relações entre linguagem e poder em contextos educacionais. Muito obrigado.
Declaro encerrada a mesa solene, né, de abertura e convido os professores a se acomodarem nos seus lugares, por favor, no auditório. Dando prosseguimento à nossa sessão de abertura, convido agora o professor Gisley Teodoro Carvalho para iniciar a homenagem ao professor Brian Street.
Acho que eu vou ficar sentado. Vocês vão entender por quê. Esse colóquio é dedicado ao professor Brian Street. Muitos de nós fomos e somos influenciados pelo trabalho do professor Brian Street. No seminal estudo sobre as práticas sociais de letramento, Street nos alertou sobre a presença dos modelos autônomos do letramento, já que esse modelo adota uma ênfase excessiva em um julgamento sobre apenas as habilidades de ler e escrever marcados pelo processo de legitimação via usos escolares da escrita. O reconhecimento dos diversos e diferentes usos da escrita permitiu a emergência de argumentos para identificar os modelos ideológicos e, portanto, evidenciar o postulado de que não existem formas e usos neutros de letramento. Mais do que isso, a indicação é de que somos muito orientados a reconhecer apenas os usos da escrita moldados em valores prévios e orientados por um etnocentrismo. A pesquisa etnográfica empreendida por Street trouxe diferentes modos de conceber o letramento, ampliando nossas percepções e nossa compreensão dos mundos da escrita, tanto em termos teóricos quanto em termos metodológicos. Em função desse programa de pesquisa e dos postulados dele derivados, Street muitas vezes foi criticado por promover um relativismo exagerado. Sua brilhante resposta sempre foi a de dizer que colocar-se na perspectiva do outro é uma ação e uma opção política de ver o mundo sob diferentes olhares. E, se ser relativista é um adjetivo usado para indicar uma visão que situa o fenômeno em relação a algo, nos seus condicionantes históricos e sociais, sim, ele afirmava ser um relativista com convicção. Eis aí um modelo ideológico em ação, pois desafia o mito da neutralidade e explicita as relações entre linguagem e poder. Muitos de nós fomos e somos influenciados pelo colega e amigo Brian, um ser humano que gostava da convivência e, mais do que isso, promovia a conexão entre as pessoas. Por isso mesmo, seu nome está registrado em todas as edições desse nosso colóquio sobre letramento e cultura escrita. Esteve conosco em todas as conversas, as de bastidores e as oficiais, nesse mesmo auditório. Essas conversas, via de regra, eram marcadas pelo desafio intelectual, o de colocar as visões em perspectiva, relativizando as explicações e desafiando as convicções apressadas e limitadas. O seu estilo de intervenção trazia uma marca bastante simpática. Todos nós dizíamos, Brian vai concordar com a sua visão, vai compartilhar o entusiasmo da sua pesquisa e seus achados. No entanto, aguarde a introdução do but, porque, nesse segundo movimento, certamente a conversa realmente vai se transformar em um debate, produtivo, respeitoso. Desafiador. Mais uma vez, a emergência de práticas sociais. Acho que não vou conseguir.
Mais uma vez? Mais uma vez, a emergência de práticas sociais de letramento em que a neutralidade não encontra lugar. Para rememorarmos essa convivência, a necessária e justa presença da voz do professor Brian Street, compartilhamos com vocês uma compilação de alguns fragmentos de discurso em direção ao restabelecimento de conexões, palavra tão apreciada por ele. Com a palavra, Brian.
So all of this has somehow fed into the building up of some ideas and concepts to do with understanding literacies in the plural across cultural contexts. What a shame, this illiterate village, they'd use the word bisavodi, which literally translated means without knowledge. People from UNESCO, which had its headquarters in Paris in those days, would come. And so all of this has somehow fed into the building up of some ideas and concepts to do with understanding literacies in the plural across cultural contexts. What a shame, this illiterate village, they'd use the word bisavodi, which literally translated means without knowledge. People from UNESCO, which had its headquarters in Paris in those days, would come and say, the only way this society would modernize, take off, become richer, is if we increase the literacy rate. What can we do about these illiterate bisavodi villagers? And I'm sitting there, trained in ethnography, which means you listen to local people, saying, but there's lots of literacy going on. And I now, in true ethnographic fashion, suspend judgment and say, let's wait. If you tell me there's no written materials, there's no literacy, there's illiteracy in all these villages, let's go involved in an alternative set of conceptual and theoretical studies, which have come to be known as new literacy studies. And the first point there was to try to characterize these different models, and I'll use the word models deliberately, to refer to conceptual frameworks that pattern and hold together notions of how the world is. And these, I would argue, were models of literacy that people were holding. They didn't always call them that. They thought what they were describing was simply what is. This is what is going on. These people are illiterate. But I want to take a step back and say, what model of literacy are you using in order to make that utterance? And it seemed to me that the account that was being given in both the theoretical literature and in the agencies and people encountering, particularly villagers in many countries, was what I came to term an autonomous model. In other words, it assumed that literacy was in some way an autonomous, separate, acultural thing, a thing that would have effects irrespective of context. Whereas my experience in the Iranian village and since then in other places tells me so that literacy, one variety of literacy, may not have the effects that you're hoping. I refer to this model as an ideological model, not just a cultural model, although it is that, but ideological because there's power rooted in these ideas. These models are powerful. They determine, for instance, resources, they determine curriculum, they determine pedagogy, they determine definitions, who is literate and who is not literate. These are powerful conceptions, powerful models. Begin to develop that, to challenge the outside agencies that are altering forestry use. So we are moving on, we're not just reproducing local practices, but we're engaging in significant political, in this case commercial, and agricultural practices, using literacy as one component to help a larger political struggle. And in the end, that of course is what we all do all the time. We're interested here in language, We're interested in understanding diversity point of view. We then need to move on and to start to ask we start by saying, what literacy practices can we find in their fixed and permanent? It could be ephemeral. A few weeks later, the local authority had wiped all this away, cleared the beach ready for the summer and the tourists. No more wood, no more writing. Just like if you write in the sand, the waves come and get rid of it. So just reminds us, although the big claims for literacy say it is permanent and oral language is transient, that divide is not quite so clear. A great deal of written work is transient. And we know now, of course, that a great deal of spoken language, theoretical can be point recorded. Reminds us, is that written material isn't always fixed and permanent. The big claims for literacy say it is permanent and oral language is transient. That divide is not quite so clear. A great deal of written work is transient. And we know now, of course, that a great deal of spoken language can be recorded. So the old great divide doesn't work in the new world. And everyday literacy practices may take a variety of forms, some of which we don't anticipate. If we start from that position as educators, we go out and design courses that build on what people know rather than assume they're empty vessels, we may have a very different kind of educational literacy. Thank you.
Depois dessa invocação de presença emotiva e intelectual, explicito alguns significados intencionados com esse hino da alma mineira e universal, presente na música Travessia, de Milton Nascimento e Fernando Brant, na voz jazzística da grande Sarah Vaughan, lançamos nossas indagações sobre as travessias, tanto as necessárias quanto as compulsórias. Podemos até de forma resignada buscar algum entendimento. But, ao professor, ao pesquisador, ao colega, ao amigo Brian Street, nossa saudade.
Convido agora a professora Andréa Machado de Almeida Matos para conduzir os trabalhos da primeira mesa do sexto do colóquio, Relações entre Letramento e Poder.
So, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming to this colloquium on a Sunday afternoon at the end of the vacation time in Brazil. Welcome, everybody. So, this first roundtable will have the theme of literacies and power relations. And I now invite the professors who will take part in the roundtable to join me here in the on the stage. Professor Brian Morgan, Professor David Bloom, and Professor Miriam Jorge. So I think I'll join them in the, on the table and speak from there. So we'll follow the order in the program. So I now introduce Professor Brian Morgan with his talk on critical multiliteracies in language teacher education, the Issues Analysis Project. Professor Brian Morgan is currently associate professor at the Department of English at Glendon College, York University in Toronto, Canada, where he is now director of English as a Second Language. He has a PhD in education from the Ontario Institute of Studies in Education, the University of Toronto. He has published widely in the area of language teaching and teacher education, including 2 books and more than 50 book chapters and articles in refereed journals. Professor Brian Morgan and I first met when we were both taking part in a joint research project on transnational literacies involving Canada and Brazil, coordinated by Professor Diana Bryden, the University of Winnipeg, and co-coordinated by Professor Valquíria Montemor at the University of São Paulo, who was my previous PhD supervisor. For me, this collaboration between Brazil and Canada has been an experience of academic growth, but also of true friendship with several Canadian scholars, including Professor Brian Morgan, who I have now the pleasure to introduce to you. Thank you very much, Brian, for accepting to come to Belo Horizonte and to take part in this roundtable.
Obrigado, Andrea, pela sua apresentação. Ok. Entendi? Yeah. Ok. So, obrigado, Andrea, pela sua apresentação. Obrigada aos organizadores pela essa oportunidade compartilhar a minha pesquisa. Infelizmente, o meu português é ainda muito básico, então, agora, eu começo a falar em inglês. So, thank you. Good, you got that out of the way. I have to practice. Preciso praticar whenever I get an opportunity. So the title of my papers on critical multiliteracies in language teacher education, the Issues Analysis Project. I was very moved by the introduction and the discussion of Brian Street's work. And I remember when I was first starting out in my studies at Ontario Institute for Studies in Education, it was a key construct for us interested in critical pedagogies and literacies, this idea of Street's key notion of moving from an autonomous model of literacy to an ideological, critical one, grounded ethnographically in specific places. And in a sense, this has been most of my work interest is I've studied applications of critical theory, but I've always been very sensitive to the critique that there's maybe too much theory and not enough grounded critical practice. And again, Street's work is an inspiration for that. The Issues Analysis Project reflects my efforts to bridge this gap between theory and practice that informs theory in critical literacies and critical multiliteracies. Recently, I've started to talk about the Issues Analysis Project as a form of advocacy apprenticeship, and I will talk more about this. And it goes back to some of the things in the video, the need to think about practical, grounded ways in which, in my case, new teachers can find a voice for themselves, but in the literacy practices specific to their profession. So what is it, what kinds of texts, genres, and literacies allow one to join this professional academic community as an English language teacher and to be heard and to participate effectively, critically, and transformatively. Now, you're probably wondering what this is. This is winter in Regina, Saskatchewan. It's quite unlike winter in Belo Horizonte. That's actually frost on that fence. It's about 30 degrees below zero. Speaking of multiliteracies, there's multiple meanings here. There's this descriptive level of meaning. You see the fence. It's very cold. We call this frost hoarfrost. You see a horizon. You see a farmer's field where I come from in Saskatchewan. There's other interesting things. There's indexical meanings. There's emotional meanings. When I see this, I'm reminded of my home. I'm reminded of the comfort I had of growing up in this place in Saskatchewan. So there's multiple meanings in this image. Another aspect of this image that I use this many times, Andrea, you've probably seen this before, this picture, and I use it as a metaphor for the teaching and preparation of teachers, particularly teachers who aspire to be transformative, critical agents in their work. And so on the horizon, you see the ideals, especially, you know, maybe younger, newer teachers, the ideals, the desires to change the lives of their students in their workplaces. But here, so the horizon, and again, it's an interesting metaphor. The horizon is the utopian, the ideal, and the proximity is the fence. And often the fence is ideological. It's the assumptions around what it means to know a language. The assumption around what it means to know. What are the epistemological foundations that we inadvertently transfer to our students as teacher educators? So you see this ideological barrier and domain. And so much of my work is interested in looking at these two dimensions, looking at the transformative dimension, what are the possibilities, the social, critical possibilities, but also what are the boundaries of knowledge? What are the ways in which the knowledge base and the kinds of literacies that we impart in teacher education and language teacher education obstruct or block that kind of horizon. So it's a visual metaphor. And I'm going to go now from that visual image, because I've talked about this presentation in the context of multiliteracies, to a denser text, print text, but from a person I'm really admire his work, Graham Crooks, and I'll read it for you. Because it models what I aspire to as a goal in critical language teacher education and the teaching of critical literacies. As a language teacher educator, I am interested in knowing how language teachers use the knowledge they are supposed to have of areas of professional practice. Second language acquisition, for instance, provides information about error treatment. But if one also thinks of language teaching as a cultural, moral, social, and political practice, then similarly it is desirable to know what informs less instrumental areas of language teachers' classroom practices or their professional work as it involves actions beyond the classroom. What is their understanding of the aims of language education in their school, culture, or country? And if so, how do they draw on these perspectives in informing action, including but also going far beyond error treatment? And again, you see this interesting comparison again to what might have been an autonomous cognitive error treatment model of being literate to clearly a critical ideological practice and some of the things that, again, pioneered by Bryan Street. So these are the kinds of underpinnings that I have or that I try to bring to, or if I position myself in this assignment that I will show you, or contextualize myself in the assignment, these are the kinds of ideas that have led to this issues analysis project. Now, I teach this assignment, the issues analysis project. I've taught it over the past 15 years in two separate settings. The first one was at York University, and it was in a certificate program to teach adult immigrants in Canada. And it was a program that prepared teachers for non-credit adult ESL. And in Ontario or in Canada, this is a provincial jurisdiction. So each province might have different things to do. In Ontario, it's probably in Toronto, has the most number of immigrants and refugees in Toronto, probably than the entire country or any other location. So in this program, this course is called the Sociopolitical Issues in Second Language Teaching. It was 3 credits in a 24-credit program. Students also did introduction linguistics. They took classes in second language acquisition, methodology, and they did a practicum. So you can see some of the course themes that students would read in preparation for the project that I'll describe. More recently, since 2009, I've been teaching a course called English as a World Language. And it is a 3-credit course, part of this certificate in the discipline of teaching English as an international language. These are the themes. The interesting thing about this program is that we do our final practicum 3 weeks in the university, Verona University in Havana, Cuba. And what's also fascinating about the practicum is that the supervisors of the practicum and the classroom mentors are Cuban, so-called non-native speaking teachers of English. So my course, a lot of it is to look at the social dimensions, the social articulations around language. Language not as a decontextual system, but a language, a notion of English language articulated or aligned with all sorts of ideological developments in the world. So we look at English in the context of spirituality issues. We look at conflict, forced migration, especially lately around the Syrian refugee crisis. We also look at language in broader semiotic modalities. We look at some of the work by Alistair Pennycook on global rap and hip hop. And also one of the most important, and we also look at issues around sexuality. We study, for example, Omo Hain's article about a queer pedagogy in a Japanese university. So issues of identity, criticality, the world in English, the English, and English in the world. Again, this idea of a social ideological language teaching. Also, what's really key in my course, and again, getting students to think about what they can do, what kinds of literacies do they need, is I bring in case studies. Case studies that are grounded in particular places that show teachers identifying the needs of their students, not as technicians, but identifying the needs and designing curricula that are socially, locally relevant. So the case studies are really critical for students, especially in an early stage or a beginning stage of what might be a career. Let me read you the assignment. It is the assignment we start to prepare for it about midway through the course. The course is 12 weeks. It's a one semester course. This course tends to be going, the course with this assignment is usually happening at the same time the methodology slash practicum course is happening. So here's what the issues analysis project aspires to, what it assumes is the identity and the role of a teacher in our field, and the kinds of literacies and genres teachers need to develop to be effective critical practitioners. The premise of the assignment is that the effective teacher is aware of the socio-political context within which she or he works. It also assumes that the instructor has a professional responsibility to attempt to deal with the issues that impact negatively on the teaching learning process and the situation of second language learners and teachers. The objective of this assignment is to select an issue and structure a response that will at least in some way work towards resolving the issue. In other words, you will produce a blueprint for action that is responsive to the issue identified and could, at least in theory, be carried out as proposed. Your response might be in the form of a new policy, advocacy initiative, curriculum innovation, specialized materials, or an in-service, pre-service workshop for teachers and or program administrators. So here, in a sense, is what I meant by calling these multiliteracies, because they're asking the teacher to participate effectively, imagine what are the kinds of texts, what are the kinds of genres, what are the kind of literacies in which your voice will be heard and your ideas respected to enter this community and have the possibility of acting on that community. So this is the nature of the assignment. Now, and again, as I mentioned, preparation for this begins halfway. It's not easy for students in a pre-service context. So bringing in examples. I bring in, for example, from TESOL, TESOL's, the organization TESOL will have examples of position papers. So we look at the rhetorical moves of an effective document, of a policy document. We look at letters to key stakeholders and politicians. Again, what are the rhetorical language elements? How much time or space do you need to do this? The same thing with a workshop. How is a workshop organized? What are the moves that bring in the knowledge of the participants? What can you do in 2 hours when you organize a workshop? What does a curriculum document look like? So these are actually the kinds of literacy, genres, texts that are field specific and perhaps even identity specific of a professional role. Now let me just go to a few of the challenges. I might as well just put these all on. These are some of the key conditions to make this assignment work. As I mentioned earlier, bringing in case studies, concrete examples, not necessarily to say the students have to imitate them, but to show them the situatedness of this particular response of a teacher in this particular settings with these kind of administrative demands. Another key component that we forget about is every day we are modeling in our interpersonal relationships with students and in the kinds of texts we produce in terms of what do we authorize in our readings, we are modeling what students may start to see as a way of doing that assignment or any assignment. So when I hand out course readings, we have course readings every week, maybe 2 or 3, I spend a lot of time thinking about what are the different reading positions. So the reading into writing. This, I remember in the video Brian talking about these, the barrier between oral and written text are not so much so, and this is a case. The kinds of conversations, interpersonal relations, are modeling the kinds of work students will start to see and the kind of practices they imagine. Then we talked about this earlier, the looking at IAP genres. And then the last point up here is an interesting one to think about with teachers. And maybe this is more of an issue for research or teacher educators? What are the implicit limits and possibilities that research paradigms create for the expectation of students? A positivistic research paradigm sees the teacher as the technician, taking the expertise, instrumentally applying it. When you start to go into more constructivist, naturalistic, participatory models, then you, with your students, you start to see that your responsibilities expand. We go into dimensions where you are openly ideologically involved in research, transforming the sites of research. And teachers having ethical questions that are central to this. So these are, again, some of the challenges and conditions. Now, let me show you a few selected IEPs that we've done over the years in these two courses. The first one was done by two older students, and at my age now I'm careful about how I qualify older. We'll say that they were nearer to retirement, and they imagined for themselves a career after leaving York University, and that career would be they would like to be international teachers. Then they started looking at websites and job ads that had age restrictions, and they were shocked. So what they did is they put together an advocacy letter to the president of TESOL, president of TESOL Ontario, recommending, and in the advocacy letter, they researched United Nations documents, EU policy documents, regarding age discrimination. And they put together this really impressive advocacy letter asserting that TESOL have a policy statement on this. The second one is one that's really interesting, again, going back to this idea of an autonomous literacy. Most of the training of ESL teachers treats language as a system, that the priority of language is learning its code, to learning it in sequence, to learning it as a progressive set of discrete grammar vocabulary items. Teachers that are unprepared for the kind of adult ESL programs in which my program was sending them to, ones in which social needs, community needs, are equally important. So this reference guide was a brilliant idea, I thought, that they would be able to take to students, student teachers or new teachers, in a sense have referral to the social ideological needs of their students. They would have this guide with community references on Ontario human rights, employment standards, tenant rights, Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. And so this is interesting to see, again, language as a social practice, deeply embedded in social context and ideological context. Okay. Oh, I'm back, sorry. Good. Now, I'd like to do two more. I hear the Portuguese translation. You go, is that what I really said? Oh, and the joke got translated too. Bol tradução. Okay. Now, the first one I'd like to talk about was a student named Cynthia. Identity here, identidade, was muito, muito importante, very important to her. Cynthia was of Afro-Caribbean descent. She had come to Toronto. And her own life story, her own life history, was one of being told she didn't speak proper English. Even though it was the language of her home, she spoke Caribbean English. In school, she was stigmatized for this. And around about 8 years ago, Cynthia, like many other students of African descent in Canada, African Canadians were finding that the curriculum in the schools was not serving their needs, that the level of dropout rates for these students was much, much higher than other ethno-racial groups in the schools. The city of Toronto decided to create, and this, I guess, very much models what happened in Oakland at the school. The city of Toronto decided that they would create an Afrocentric high school. Cynthia said for this that she was going to create a language and education policy recommendations and curricular examples. Now, one of the key things that she talked about was that she was going to recommend in her policy is that Caribbean English be used as a parallel language of compare, a contrastive language for students in this program to be able to look at the dominant language, but still validate and valorize their language from home, or the first dialect from home. And I use that word dialect very precariously, because again, that's such a stigmatized term. When is one's dialect? Who gets to speak the dialect? Who gets to speak the language? Other things that she talked about in her proposal that were really interesting is that she referred to the work of Paulo Freire, that teachers need to see themselves as community agents involved in empowerment issues and involved in consciousness raising, conscientiousness critical. And then she also worked on cultural sensitivity issues for this course. Now I'm going to go to the last one here. This is still Cynthia's, yeah. So you see, quote, the lived historical experiences of black students are either largely excluded or framed in simplistic, non-specified terms in curricular content. And you also see the rationale that she has here. And George Day is one of the leading scholars for African-Canadian educational issues and policies. Okay, and here were Cynthia's recommendations. Teachers be retrained to think of themselves as cultural workers, an intercultural multiple perspective, a social action approach, and then this is the key for her in her own identity experience, Caribbean Englishes be recognized and utilized. And then she talked about dual language texts, which is an interesting idea, texts that are written in both the first language and the second language, compositions, and then this listening exercise using the talking stick, where this big stick is passed around from each participant in the group, requiring all the participants to listen respectfully. So that was Cynthia's blueprint for action. Here's a final quote from Cynthia. I became more acutely aware of the intricate relationship that exists between language, culture, and identity. The extensive media focus given to the Afrocentric proposal also took me right back to my own earlier experiences as a Caribbean immigrant, being ridiculed for something as natural as speaking my own language, and really helped me to make connections I wasn't able to until now. So what's also interesting about these projects is not that people inscribe their identity, that they take and they produce these texts based on their identity, but that the texts become a mirror, that there's this kind of performance of doing this project, as this quote reminded me, doing the project and doing literacies, they don't simply reflect our identities, they shape our identities. And that was one of the key things that happened here. The last one I'd like to talk about is Peace Education Through Transformative Learning, a comprehensive workshop. The identity issues. One of the participants was a Pakistani-Canadian woman named Sarah. Sarah was concerned about how Pakistan was being presented in the media. It was being presented in the dominant mainstream media as a Muslim country, and that all Muslim countries inherently are violent. So the picture of Pakistan and the Islamophobia in the media at this time motivated her to do this project. Her and her partner and Clara decided that they would create a project for experienced EFL, English as a Foreign Language teachers in Pakistan, that they would get together and that they would have a 4 concurrent activities workshop. There's 4 parts to this. Activity 1, she would have the participants meeting together, sharing their own experiences, what they imagined a social justice curriculum would look like. what kinds of social inequalities from different regions of Pakistan they identified. They would collaborate on that. The second activity was looking specifically at vocabulary. And as they described in the workshop, students, especially in an international setting, may have an abstract, autonomous, denotative notion of what vocabulary would be. Their practice here, number two, was to take this vocabulary, talk about it in an engaged way, and relate the vocabulary to specific cases. So going from denotative to more situated and connotative understandings of their vocabulary. Activity three is where they brought in, and they found this from an organization called the Institute for War and Peace, which suggested that they could bring in a visiting speaker, that they could join a network of international peace educators and have an opportunity to build this kind of network to see themselves outside of the Pakistan context. The final one, very interesting, is that they came from a context in which teachers tend to be very authoritarian. And what they suggested here is that together with students, we will negotiate what the classroom rules will be. And probably some of you have tried this before. It's a challenge. Getting the students working together and defining what would be the way in which we run our classroom. So again, interesting ideas as what they saw in terms of a peace curriculum. And here I have a final quote from Sarah. We want to do Pakistan as a context for a TIL workshop because we believe it to be an under-addressed country in relation to its other South Asian and Southeast Asian counterparts. We thought that we would make a connection between peace education, transformative learning, and ESL. English used to be well-spoken and practiced language countrywide, but due to the recent political climate, its use sometimes can be an indicator of socio-political and economic siding. We saw the need, therefore, to provide a workshop for pre-service and in-service teachers to gain knowledge of their cultural surroundings and manifest that in their teaching, and to make them more sensitive and receptive to their roles as teachers, as agents of influence and change. Positive or negative as developing educators. Okay, so again, this idea of language as a social practice, language teachers needing more than a knowledge of an autonomous literacy, an autonomous set of linguistic vocabulary skills, also needing to see the social world in which they work. Now, just some final reflections on the paper. Oh, sorry, on the project, the IAP project issues analysis. So what are the strengths of this project? And it's still a work in progress for me. The important thing, again, is what kinds of literacies, texts, and genres do new teachers need to have their voices heard, to have the possibility to build consensus, to build coalitions, and act collectively to transform their work environments. They need to have this sense, this literate genre knowledge of the texts that are dominant in their field. What is also important about this is teachers start to see themselves as researchers, to make more explicit the movement that all our students do, going from the authoritative discourses of the official curriculum to discourses that are internally persuasive, that they make their own, that Bakhtin idea. Teacher agency is key. What kinds of ways in which we can help teachers to, again, see themselves as not just the users of others' knowledge, but the creators of their own and their own literacies. And again, thinking about the texts and literacies across multiple modalities, experiences, and embodied experiences and principles of learning. Couple of small disadvantages that I've found with this. It's a difficult project to do when students are in a pre-service context. So again, bringing in many exemplars helped. And one of the problems I often have with students in this busy world that we live in is some of them often feel that they are too busy to have the time to actually do projects. They say, oh, I can't meet with other students. Oh my God, I'm too busy. So one of the key arguments to make, if you ever want to change your workplace, if you ever want to bring any kind of change into places of work or in your society, you need to learn and try to work collaboratively, to build a community of like-minded critical teachers. And so this idea of project-based multiliteracies, I think, supports that. And that's all I have to say other than enjoy your winters here, because it could be much worse. Thank you. Obrigado.
Thank you, Brian, for your talk. We'll leave the questions to the end. I now invite Professor David Bloom to give his talk. The title is Reading Comprehension as Intertextual Practice, Language Literacy and Power in the Classroom. Professor David Bloom is Distinguished Professor of Teaching and Learning in the School of Teaching and Learning of the Ohio State University College of Education and Human Ecology. Professor David Bloom is also director of the Center for Video Ethnography and Discourse Analysis of the School of Teaching and Learning and co-director in the Columbus Area Writing Project. Before becoming a professor, he was a classroom teacher of reading, writing, and the language arts at the middle school and high school levels. His research and teaching focus on how people use spoken and written language for learning in classroom and non-classroom settings, and how people use language to create and maintain social relationships, to construct knowledge, and to create communities, social institutions, and shared histories and futures. His current scholarship focuses on six areas related to writing and reading education. First, the social construction of intertextuality as part of the reading, writing, and learning processes. Discourse analysis as a means for understanding reading, writing, and literacy events in and outside of classrooms. Narrative development among young children as a foundation for learning and literacy development in schools. Students as researchers and ethnographers of their own communities. Literacies as a set of social relationships connecting people to each other in urban environment, and the teaching and learning of argumentative writing. I met Professor David Bloom a few years ago during one of the many times he has come to Brazil to be in contact with this group here at the Faculty of Education. In 2015, I was part of the organizing committee of the Academic Literacies Conference here in Belo Horizonte, and Professor David Bloom was one of the scholars invited. And last year, I was very lucky to be invited to contribute in a keynote panel at The Ohio State University. And I take this opportunity to thank Professor David Bloom again for this invitation. Thank you, Professor David Bloom, for joining us this time again in Brazil in this colloquium.
Does this microphone work? Yeah. Great. I hope you will not mind if I stand. It's sort of my cultural background to speak with my hands and my body, so it will be better if I stand. I want to thank the UFMG and Ciali for sponsoring this colloquium and providing me and others with an opportunity to share our work with you. I'm going to share with you today a theoretical argument. Actually, it's a continuation of a conversation that I had with Brian Street in September 2016 when we were sitting in his apartment overlooking the Brighton seafront. And our conversation was punctuated, as Professor Cavallo noted, with a lot of yes buts. So you may hear a lot of yes buts in this talk that I am giving you. All right. Let me share with you my goal. My goal is to begin deconstructing and then reconstructing the notion of reading comprehension. I'm going to do this grounded in a series of theoretical perspectives which are listed below, but all of these take the view of language as a transitive verb, an action that people take with each other. It is to ask who is using language to do what, to whom, with whom, and how. And you'll see that comes up again and again. This is part of a broader argument about reading and literacy as materially enacted. In my view, dominant models of reading comprehension, and we'll get to those in a second, create a kind of alienation of people from themselves and from each other. And I think it's just fundamentally and materially inaccurate. And I'll try to make that argument to you. So this is how I'm going to proceed today. I'm going to first begin by problematizing current understandings of reading comprehension. I'm going to discuss a few theoretical constructs leading to a reconstruction of reading comprehension as intertextual practice. I'm going to provide some examples of viewing reading comprehension.
The translation.
Okay. Yes. I will slow down. As I said, I will problematize current understandings of reading comprehension, discuss a few theoretical constructs leading to a reconstruction of reading comprehension as intertextual practice. I will provide some examples of viewing reading comprehension as intertextual practice, and then I will make some final comments at the end. All of this is premised on a notion that the essential unit of analysis is people acting and reacting to each other, and they do so primarily through language and related semiotic systems. This concept, which I'm not going to talk about too much tonight, I view as essential. That is, it is the essence of things, as opposed to just one of several kinds of constructs. It is to emphasize that as people, we are in relationship to each other all the time, whether we want to acknowledge it or not. And what we do is in context of other people all the time, whether we want to acknowledge that or not. Yeah. So you will see this unit of analysis in this frame come back again and again and again in the argument that I am making. This, if you will, is a sketch of the dominant conceit, the dominant model of reading comprehension. An individual, a single individual, with a single text in which that single individual is interacting with that single text, creating some kind of meaning in their head. Now, there might be social factors that interfere with how well they do it or enhance how well they do it, but it is primarily cognitive and linguistic. It is not at all essentially social. And it is certainly not people acting and reacting to each other. It is the application of a series of cognitive processes and strategies and linguistic processes and strategies to create a meaning, if you will, or if to use the term of cognitive science, to create a situation model, if you will, a text-based and a situation model. Part of this model assumes that there is a target text, the text you are reading, and that through reading comprehension processes, you come up with a meaning text, if you will, the text-based and the situation model. Now, we enact this in classrooms. We have our students read a target text, and we assume and try to teach them the cognitive processes they should be using to arrive at a meaning text. I think we need to ask some questions about this, however. Where is this meaning text? Where does it exist? How do we know it exists? What happens to it? What is it constituted of? Why a meaning text? I don't know about you, but when I was in school and I was sitting and asked to read a text, I must admit I wasn't a very good student. My eyes would be on the text, but I would really be thinking about how can I disrupt the class? How can I make the teacher have a hard time since I thought the teacher was giving me a hard time? I told you I was not a very good student. But I think we need to problematize this and think about this. If someone is reading something and they come up with a meaning of it, how do we know what that is until they make it public? And once they make it public, it's no longer them and the target text and the meaning text. Now all of a sudden, it's social. I remember when I was in seventh grade and we were reading The Merchant of Venice. I knew then, since I was the only Jewish child in the classroom, not to say that this was an anti-Semitic text. So I didn't say it was an anti-Semitic text, though it's an anti-Semitic text, as at least as I saw it. So what happened to the meaning text there? The meaning text was less a cognitive process than it was a social, cultural, political process involving my interaction with other people in that classroom and their interactions with me and broader cultural ideologies about what constituted reading. In my view and in my research, reading looks more like this, particularly in schools and in classrooms, anywhere else but academics' offices. Multiple people interacting with multiple texts, talking with each other, reading the text all at the same time. This is more what reading materially looks like and is enacted to be. People acting and reacting to each other with language, spoken and written at the same time. This is the essence of reading and reading comprehension. And if we start thinking about building our theories off of this conceit, this model, rather than the previous one, all of a sudden, our previous notions all sort of become vague and fade away. And we have to re-theorize it. And that is part of what I want to do. Indeed, what I'd like to do is shift the notion of a meaning text to the notion of meaning, social significance, and cultural import. That is to shift from meaning as meaning text to meaning as social effects, actions, relationships, doings, and events, and so forth. It is to ask, how has the language van here, reading comprehension, implicated and affected the social context, social systems, and social processes that both constitute the event and are themselves constituted by the event? These effects are nonlinear, unpredictable, and indeterminate. Meaning of social effects is always indexical, such that any micro-social interaction is always and inherently inseparable from macro-sociological context. Now, this notion of things always being indexical means that the indexicality is always at question, is always evolving, is always contestable and contested. So the notion that somehow or other a meaning is stable and is indexical of some kind of meaning system, I think needs to be called into question as we socially interact with each other over time and across events. Once we accept such a definition of meaning, then we are able to see things not previously available to us to see or that were invisible. Let me share with you this heuristic, which is impossible to read, but I will try to explain what I had meant by it. It is a sort of a heuristic. The first thing to notice is at the very top. We can no longer look at a single social event and ask what is happening here, but rather we must understand that any social event is always connected to other social events. No social event is ever in isolation of others. And once we accept that as fundamental, then the question we have to ask is, how is the social event related to what other social events and how to what effect? By whom and how? So that is the first thing we have to do. And if you think about that in terms of reading comprehension in schools, we can no longer ask, What does this text mean? What does this book mean? What does this article mean? Because it must be seen as connected to other social events that have happened and that will happen and that people will be participating in. We must also understand that across these events, there's all ongoing reflection and refraction of cultural ideology. What does that mean? That the indexicality of anything we read continues to evolve and change and may be contested. So, earlier presentation mentioned the work of Mikhail Bakhtin. That was a sort of reference, and we now might take that frame in there and we might think, oh, there is a certain kind of ideology that goes along with the Bakhtinian view of things, right? Then you and I start talking and you tell me what you think a Bakhtinian framework is, and I go, yes, but did you think about this? And you said, I did, but did you think about this? And it evolves and it changes. It becomes reflected and refracted over time. An ongoing evolution of social relationships and social positionings. Imagine this happening in a classroom. A student says something, it makes a comment. And you as the teacher say, well, I really wish you would stop disrupting class. That would be somebody saying something to me. And then the student explains their answer. And all of a sudden the teacher says, oh, I had it wrong. That's really brilliant. I guess you are one of our brightest students. Right? What happened? Social positioning and social identity started to change and evolve over time as you go from one event to another event to another event and over time. And relationships change. An ongoing evolution of the meaning text. I'm sure this has happened to you. You read something one time and you had a conversation about it in your classroom and you came to sort of a consensus about what it meant until you came the next day. And all of a sudden, that conversation continued, and what that book you thought you knew what it meant no longer means that. Huh? Things, the meaningfulness we assign to a printed text or any other piece of language, keeps evolving and changing. And so also the reconstruction of intertextual and intercontextual connections. And here I need to talk just a little bit about what we mean, or at least what I mean, by intertextuality. Many people talk about intertextuality as if it is an explicit relationship between one printed text and another printed text, such as you get when you have a citation in it, right? That's a sort of kind of intertextuality. Have you ever read something that had a lot of citations in it, and you just decided you were going to read the text and ignore the citations because you had class in 20 minutes and didn't have time to think about all the citations? Are those citations then intertextual connections or not? I would say they don't really exist in that moment, in that social event. Intertextuality is socially constructed. It's not given in a text. And it's not given by the teacher. Teachers try it all the time. And if the students don't take it up, it fails. So even teachers know intertextuality has to be socially constructed. We say things, and the students give us a blank look, and we know no connection and uptake was made. So we have to work to try to make that connection until we get some uptake on them, or we just give up, as the case might be. So, if we think about intertextuality as a social construction, it's made up of at least four processes. An intertextual proposal is made, it is acknowledged by interlocutors, it is recognized by interlocutors, and it's given meaning, significance, and import by those interlocutors. Let me give you an example. Let's say you are in a classroom, and a student says something, and the teacher says, "Who's on first?" Some of you are laughing because you know you have recognized, you have acknowledged that an intertextual connection is being made. maybe all of you did. Only some of you actually recognize that connection, which is to an Abbott and Costello routine, right? For those of you who don't know who Abbott and Costello are, first, you are making me feel very old. Secondly, they were a comedy team in the United States a very long time ago. And they did a routine on baseball. Who's on first? What's on second? I don't know, on third is the names of baseball players. And then it has to be given meaning and significance. The meaning could be social, such as in, I am criticizing you, I am making fun of you, or I am sharing a bond with you because we both understand the same humor and I can tease you in a good spirited way. A lot of kinds of work are being done. But unless all four conditions are made, we have not socially constructed an intertextual connection. Because an intertextual connection involves people acting and reacting to each other. It is not just given. Yeah? Okay. Now, intertextuality also involves a series of power relations. It involves the establishment of boundaries on the set of texts that may be intertextually related in any specific event or set of events, and it involves participant rights. Who gets to make what intertextual links, when, where, how, and with what social consequence? So imagine this classroom situation. If you were a teacher, I'm sure this has happened to you. You are having a conversation about some topic. The student who continuously disrupts your class and continuously tries to disrupt your class, someone like me, makes an intertextual connection to Playboy magazine. Do you have Playboy magazine here? All right. Okay. I guess some things are transcultural. So, you as the teacher think to yourself, and you act, and you say, stop disrupting my class. You know that's inappropriate to do in our classroom. Okay. The very next day, you're having a conversation, and the brightest, most intelligent student in your classroom responds by making a connection to Playboy magazine. And you say, how creative, how interesting, how mature. This is what we mean when we talk about intertextual participation rights. The right to make intertextual connections is not equally distributed in any particular social group or social setting. And those are about power relations, about who gets to make what intertextual connections, when, where, and how. And perhaps it's happened to you sometime. You've been in a conversation and you've said something and everybody sort of goes blank. Like they have no idea what you're referencing. And then somebody else says it and everybody says, oh, that's a brilliant idea. Same sort of issue that happens there. Okay. So let's now take a look at some classroom examples of some things that have happened in some classrooms to try to make these theoretical constructs and ideas more concrete. This is a seventh grade classroom in which the students are reading a novel. The novel happens to be Lottery Rose, and the students had the assignment the day before to read a passage from the novel. And after they read a passage from the novel, they were to find some part that they felt was really important and that they wanted to talk about. So the teacher turns to Barbara and says, Barbara, read that, being the passage that she had selected, read that for us, please. Barbara has the book in front of her, and the whole class, of course, is there. And Barbara reads, and she reads as I'm going to mimic how she read this passage. Miss Preston didn't like Georgie much. She got mad at him for not doing his work. she pointed to, the work she pointed to, when she wrote a long list on the blackboard, she got especially, and then some other student comes in, she got especially, and then Barbara goes, she got especially mad at Georgie because he played hooky and so forth, okay? She was orally reading it out loud, a student, she got lost a bit, and another student jumped in without teacher permission to correct her and so forth. So let's take a look at this a little bit. I've deliberately chosen this because this is an oral reading passage. And often when we talk about literacy in terms of autonomous and ideological models, we don't talk about it in terms of oral reading. We talk about it in terms of interpretation and so forth. And one of the criticisms of that work has been that you don't really get down to decoding. But here we have a decoding issue of what's going on. I think there's more here than decoding going on. This is a particular reading practice. The kind of way that Barbara read it actually has a name. It's called Basil Ease. I don't know if you have Basils here, but Basils are textbooks that students who are beginning read from, yeah? Beginning primer readers. And because they are supposed to read them out loud, they read them in that sort of halting way. It's a practice. It's a way they learn how to read out loud. It is a model of what's expected to do with print. Part of this model of what's expected to do with print is don't make a mistake. Better you should be nervous, have a stomach ache, then make a mistake. Now, I say this deliberately because a practice is not just about what you do, it's also about the affect, about the social, about all of the emotional, all of those dimensions are part of a practice. Yeah? So what's happening here is not just technical. It is not just a skill. This is a social practice being enacted, and it is a shared social practice, so much so that the unidentified student, feeling bad for Barbara, jumps in to correct her to help her. Help her fulfill the particular cultural model being enacted at that time. Yeah. Now, I want you to imagine, I don't know how many of you, whether your church or synagogue experiences are like those in the United States, but imagine being in a religious service, and at least in some, different people read things out loud. And the whole idea of that reading those prayers and those religious texts is not to see how well you read. The whole purpose of that practice is to say it out loud as part of your way with others of getting closer to God. Yeah? All right. Correcting somebody in the middle of them getting closer to God would be terrible. You wouldn't do it. But it's okay to do in school. That tells us it's a practice. It's not just a skill. Yeah? That comparison. Let's take another example. Same classroom. Whoops. All right. This is later in the lesson, and the teacher is trying to get the students to relate to the main character. The main character had done a whole series of terrible things in school and elsewhere. All right. So the teacher says to the students, I was once Georgie, now I'm Helen, pointing to another student, okay? Now, what's interesting here is that with few exceptions, all of the students in this class are African American. They all come from one community, one neighborhood, and almost all of them attend the same church. In this church, there is a frequent refrain you can hear almost every Sunday. I was lost, but now I'm found. Right? It's a refrain again and again and again. And when we talked to the teacher about this, she said, absolutely, that's exactly what I was doing. I was going for that link. I was lost. I used to be a bad student. But now I'm found. Now I'm Helen. I'm no longer a bad student. And she said, I was absolutely trying to get them to connect to a cultural text they were familiar with. And then later, what's interesting is we start to see the students pick it up because they mimic the rhythm. I was lost and now I'm found, right? But there are other things going on here. Helen says, if I didn't do my work and stuff, my mother would get on my case, is what it was, and so I changed, is really what she's saying here. And then we see the students laughing. This is an example of the students understanding the connection between Helen's story and their understanding of the intertextual connection it makes. Their laughter is a social positioning of Helen. It is an acknowledgement of the intertextuality that's going on, as well as a recognition of that story that's going on there as well. Great, thank you. All right. Oh, one other bit I wanted to make about this. This is about morality. And what I want to suggest is that every use of language, every intertextual connection, always has a moral dimension to it. And the question about that moral dimension is not, does it have a moral dimension, but what is the nature of the moral dimension that it has? And in this one, it is social positioning Helen as a good student now. And it has a moral ideology to it, which is basically Christian ideology about you can be bad, but you can be saved. Yeah? And which is what is going on here. Now, this is another class. This is the ninth grade class, and they're discussing Alice Walker's story, Everyday Use. So the teacher asked one student to summarize the story, and Lisa says, they're talking about how different their daughters are from each other. Her daughter comes back to visit for a while, and she's just totally different, like she's not the same. She wants to be different. She doesn't want to be what she used to be. She doesn't want to be what they are. All right? Now, this is really interesting because in the story, there's a family that is a very rural family that's relatively poor. One of the daughters goes off to college, gets a college education, becomes financially better off, and then comes back. She has also changed her name. She has changed her name to reflect her African American heritage. So they're talking. But this whole notion that this new daughter doesn't want to have anything due to her family is a meaning that is created by these students as an intertextual link to our moral narrative that they have connected it to, and it is only through that intertextual link that they come up with this interpretation. Because other students who have read it never come up with this meaningfulness of it or of it at all. So what's interesting here is how intertextuality creates a moral ideology for judgment not only of characters in a story, but also for the students themselves. Ms. Smith also asks, tell me to the students, what is the lifestyle? Terrence says, they are real close. She's talking about the family being real close. Ms. Smith, they are real close? How do you know? I did, give me some evidence. When I ask for evidence, give me quotes. Now, in the United States, there is a big emphasis now on argumentative writing, argumentative reading, making arguments, using evidence and warrants and backing and so forth. Okay? That's a sort of genre. That's a sort of way of thinking about things. But it is more than that. It is a form of rationality. It is a sort of form of logics. Now, what's interesting is that the teacher and education in general assumes that there is only one philosophy of rationality, that what's reasonable and logical is only of one kind. When, if we read Habermas, Gadamer, Kant, or a number of other philosophers, we know that rationality is a contestable idea. What counts as rationality is contestable. And what I want to point out to you here is that what this teacher is doing through these intertextual connections, here the connection to a genre of argumentation, is she is promoting a particular kind of rationality, if you will, a kind of hidden curriculum through intertextuality. Okay. Let me make some final comments now to remind you of what I've at least tried to do. I've tried to deconstruct the dominant conceit of reading comprehension, then reconstructed it as intertextual practice. I've talked about the fundamental essential unit being people acting and reacting to each other primarily through language and related semiotic systems. I've talked about moving meaning from meaning text to meaning as publicly constructed and negotiated meaning texts, social significance, and cultural import, highlighting the importance of reflection and refraction and the evolution of social identities and positionings, the evolution of a public meaning text, and the reconstruction of intertextual and intercontextual links. I've emphasized the shift to literacy as social and cultural practices events. I've mentioned and talked about the fact that intertextuality is socially constructed, consisting of at least those four processes that I've identified there, and that intertextuality is implicated in power relations among people and institutions as well. Okay. In the classroom examples, I've talked about even oral reading as being intertextual in ideological literacy practice. We've talked a little bit, though I've not used the word, about reading comprehensions and interpolation, the imposition of a particular discourse from one place into a different institution. We've talked about reading and comprehension as an intertextual practice of morality. We've talked about reading comprehension as intertextual practice of rationality as well. The goal I started out with about 25 minutes ago was to deconstruct and reconstruct reading comprehension. Talked about reading comprehension as an intertextual practice in order to do that. This is part of a larger intellectual project of thinking about the everyday social life of people acting and reacting to each other through language and related semiotic systems. Even if you only partially accept what I've been trying to argue here, let me suggest that even so, the next question we should ask ourselves is, that view of reading comprehension as intertextual practice, how does that help us make particular things visible that were previously invisible to us looking in classrooms? To whom does it make things visible? And with what meanings, social significance, and cultural import? Making reading comprehension as intertextual practice, what effect does that have on whom? On the ideologies of schooling, classroom life, and education as well. And let me finally say, I can hear Brian now saying, yes, but. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. David, for this very inspiring talk. I now invite Professor Miriam Jorge to to talk at this round table.
So all of this has somehow fed into the building up of some ideas and concepts with understanding literacies, in the plural, across cultural contexts. What a shame, this illiterate village.
Okay, let's restart here. So Professor Miriam Jorge has a PhD in applied linguistics from the Federal University of Minas Gerais, where she is currently associate professor and teaches graduate and undergraduate students at the School of Education. She specializes in English teacher education, and her main research interests include narrative inquiry, foreign language teacher development, critical pedagogy, and issues of race. She was visiting professor at the Department of Black Studies, University of California, in Santa Barbara in 2004, and also at the Department of Anthropology at the University of North Carolina in Charlotte in 2012. She has published widely in Brazil and abroad and is the co-author of Literaturas Africanas and Afro-Brasileiras na Prática Pedagógica, African and Afro-Brazilian Literatures in Pedagogic Practice. She has also been Vice Director of International Affairs from 2014 to 2017. I first met Professor Miriam Jorge when we were both MA students at the Linguistic Studies program at Faculdade de Letras. After some time, when we were already professors at the university, we started doing some collaborative work on teacher education. Today, we do a lot of work together, both in teaching and research, and we have become very close friends. So for me, it's a real pleasure and an honor to introduce Professor Miriam Jorge to you.
I think I'll stand up, I'll be standing too. And first of all, I'm a professor here at the School of Education, and I had to make a decision about what language to use, what language to speak, as English is really a foreign language for me. And because we are talking about advocacy here, we are talking about education, power relations, I decided I was going to speak English as the language. I was playing with the words, my English, my rules, my language, my rules, minha línguas, minhas regras. because in order to be here, able to speak English and face an audience like this, I had to overcome and go through a journey of where I found not only me, but language learners in Brazil find many fences, and we have to go and overcome myths and ideas and representations of native speakers, representations of teachers of English, and other notions and concepts related to what it means to know a language, a foreign language. And then I became a teacher educator, and I had to make decisions and to learn and do research about the same things, the same fences that my student teachers would have to overcome in order to promote language education in Brazilian schools. So the title of the presentation is a little long, as you can see, and my focus will be about foreign language teaching in Brazilian schools, mostly English, and I'll talk about critical teacher education. And I decided to use the word intentionality, not because I want to discuss the philosophical meaning of intentionality, but because once critical practices became a part of a larger agenda in Brazil, lots of scholars claim to value and accept that our role is to be critical educators, and the word critical has since then been used with so many different meanings. And now I think we need to remind ourselves that what we are doing, we need to do it with the intention of doing it. Just believing, being a critical educator is not enough. Just agreeing and using those words in the texts we write or the classes we teach is not enough. And right now, because of all this idea of BNCC, the Brazilian standards, as Bases Nacionais Curriculares, we have a different moment in the history of language education or education in Brazil that can either lead us to a different place or allow us to continue in what I will ask question here as a pedagogy of sameness. So the overview of this presentation, and I have to tell you, I know I'm gonna change it because I understand this space as a space for a conversation. And because I have my colleagues here, which it is a pleasure to be here in the same round table with Professor David Bloom, Brian Morgan, and Andrea Matos, it's for me very important that everybody participates in the conversation because I want to be more provocative than bringing answers, as we are still learning a lot about the meanings and consequences of this BNCC in our context. So because I know in the audience not everybody is a language teacher, but probably everybody has taken language classes at school, I will focus a little bit in the history of languages in Brazilian schools, and then introduce some reflections on the meanings of these standards for language education or language teaching in our schools, think about and problematize the roles of teacher educators, and we start a discussion with everybody. So, these images I have here are kind of biographical. I went to this school here in the bottom of the slide. Do you know what school that is, the pink school? I was a student at Instituto de Educação, yes, of Minas Gerais, and I like to use the two pictures in the bottom of the page to show what schools used to look like in a time that just a few people had access to education in Brazil. And I also have the picture of Colégio Pedro II in Rio, because it's a reference of language teaching in Brazil. Specifically, when you see and study the history of that school, and when the elite would attend public schools or Colégio Pedro II, language education would include Greek, Latin, French, English, and German. When I attended the school at Instituto de Educação, we had English and French, and or English or French. And nowadays, we know that foreign languages are in schools as part of this yes, but situation of, okay, we are going to teach English, we are going to teach foreign languages, but. So we can think about the history and our roles as applied linguists in Brazil, considering that this but, at first, people would say, why teach English if nobody's going to leave the country? So this was a time that traveling abroad was really expensive. It's not that it's cheap nowadays, but we know that in the past it was even more difficult to live abroad or to travel to any other countries, even within South America. Then after that, okay, yes, but they will want, these students are not going to apply for college. They're not going to take this national entrance exam that we call vestibular. And then we would insist on, if we didn't teach them, if students, if these students in public schools had a chance to, or if their families had planned for them to go to college, and they didn't know the language, they wouldn't pass that exam. They would fail and not have a chance to advance in their education. Okay, yes, but they don't need to speak English because in vestibular, there is no oral language. They just need to read, and so on and so forth. We have had all these conversations in the past years, and I'm calling them conversations that are, in Portuguese, efervescentes. And I wanted to have that idea that when something is efervescent, you have all the buzz, the fizz, and then there is nothing else, and people stop talking about that, and we. But things need to change, and we don't want to persist and to continue with the teaching experience that leads us to make so many jokes about where the book is. And do you know where the book is? Yes, the book is on the table. Yes. And so when we talk about methodologies and approaches to teaching foreign languages, we use the metaphor of a pendulum. And as a teacher educator now, I am debating if I should use the same metaphor in terms of what choices we've been making. I've been teaching here at the School of Education for 20 years now, and when I read my students' papers and I change my practices, the literature, the schools where they do their practicum, but I observe that their reflections are much of the same. Texts I've read 20 years ago are very similar to texts I read nowadays, and I have to ask, what is it that we're doing that we change methodologies, we change understandings of language education, the roles of the teachers, but when a teacher goes to school and decides on how to analyze, what to reflect on, and what to act upon as teachers of English, why are the discourses so similar? And then this has a lot to do with the main theme of this meeting here, that is power relations, right? Schools and teachers and learners still do not have the same rights and are the same opportunities to advocate for the quality of language education they need or they want. And So while we as scholars and researchers are debating if we should focus on reading, and in Brazil there was this approach, Inglês Instrumental. Has anybody here ever taken classes of Inglês Instrumental? Yes, Inglês Instrumental, or communicative language teaching, or sometimes you learn English and you say, but this is Inglês de Colégio, as if we had created our own dialect or any other idea. And I've seen, long time ago, after I left Instituto de Educação, where it was rare to have a student that attended a private language institute. Now we think it's natural that you go to school not to have English classes, or not to learn English, maybe to have English classes, but to go to a language institute to learn that language. So that somehow became natural. And now, as you'll see, I will say we have another moment to start this conversation that seems to be a conversation we start over and over and over. Because we have answers, but we don't have actions, or we don't see changes taking place. We have actions. I don't want to be so cruel to ourselves in terms of saying that we haven't done anything. We have done a lot, but why do we have to insist on the same principles of the importance of teacher education, teaching foreign languages? And this is reflected also, this over and over, and this repetition in the teacher education reforms and how we implement those reforms, where in times when practicum become more and more important, people, my colleagues here at the School of Education have probably remember when we had reforms that would tell us to take students to be 300 hours of field work in a school or 800 hours of practicum, and how we handle those in reality, how we are doing that kind of teacher education. And at what extent do we involve the schools, the communities, and families in this process of education so that maybe we can really change what's going on in this context. So more recently, we have seen a growth in this movement of critical literacies in Brazil. And I say it started nationally with this document, Orientações Curriculares para o Ensino Médio. And we are member, I think Andrea and I and Brian, of a national research project, and that is coordinated by the University of São Paulo. But it's not a project of USP, it's a project of all of us, because we have researchers and scholars working in every region. I think now we've covered all the states, yes? Yeah, 27 universities in Brazil, and we are working on this idea of critical literacies. And I'd like to highlight what Valeria that mentioned today, that the word literacy is not yet written in the BNCC anymore. So the understanding of language there through the standards, it starts with an idea of English as a lingua franca, with no problematization of the meanings of English as a foreign language, a lingua franca, additional language, just again naturalizes that we need an international language, and English plays the role of this international language. But we want to, what we do is to criticize and problematize that it can be an international language, however, depending on who speaks it, what ethnicity of the speaker we are talking about, where does the speaker is from, and other layers of the identities of the speakers of the language, and other issues that we consider when, and I like to say, images that are part of what we think when we think about speaking, listen, and understanding and using a foreign language for communication. So these conversations have created spaces for books like this. I have two of our colleagues, Professor Diogenes, like English in Public Schools Doesn't Work. And this is a book that is very popular among teachers of English because we need to have these conversations. I think it was published in 2011. And another one of conversations with specialists. Again, scholars from all over Brazil trying to say that, yes, it's possible to teach listening. Yes, it's possible to teach English in public schools. So our discourses and our theories lead us to spaces that are not so domesticated in terms of what we understand that education or language education should be. And more recently, with the national program of textbooks, we have Brazilian authors writing textbooks that will reflect a lot of what our voices as Brazilian scholars demand or would like to have in textbooks. I have pictures of some old textbooks from Instituto de Educação once more, representing a time that English was, our languages were seen as a system, and learning a language was to learn some structures. So the book has structural English with audiovisual aids. And from that textbook, that was very meaningful, having Professor Solange Ribeiro de Oliveira, who is a professora emerita at UFMG, it was a great step for Brazil to have its own voice in terms of materials designing, as well as her book, A Trip to the Moon, when she decided to... Oh, I'm not sorry, A Trip to the Moon. I'm sorry. Yes. It's a book about when she has characters talking about Brazil to foreigners, trying to bring a Brazilian voice or identity to what was supposed to be taught in our schools. And more recently, it was very coherent when Professor Solange Ribeiro wrote those books, and when we were learning with those books and at school, it was very coherent with where the pendulum was, right? It was the time of structuralism, behaviorism, and psychology, and teaching languages through audiolingual method. And it did work. I still remember the very first text in that blue book, which stated, "Today is Sunday. The sun is in the sky. It's 9 o'clock in the morning." Those are Kate and Paul Brown. I remember that. We had to memorize. We had to learn structures. I've been there. I've survived it. Or I participated in that time. And also, I've participated in this time of the National Program for Textbooks when we had a chance to write a call for proposals, edital, for the Ministry of Education. And we included important perspectives like world Englishes, issues of identity such as race, class, diversity of speakers, of Afrocentric perspectives. And this was a huge kind of a difficult situation when some people in the team did not want to use the word race in our assessment criteria, because race is a still controversial issue in Brazil. We feel more comfortable now talking about race, but it wasn't like that all the time. So being comfortable with a word or with an idea doesn't mean that we are ready to really act and change situations. And I'm not going to read this, but for many years, I've used this text written by Rubem Braga, 1945, And when he writes about his experience learning English, when he's so happy that he finally answers the questions of his teacher, that who shows him a picture, is this an ashtray? And he can say, it's not an ashtray. And he's very happy of course, it's ironical. And this is a 1945 text. In 67, we have Cecilia Meirelles explaining how she wanted to read literature in English and how difficult it was for her to finally have a text that was meaningful or that would really respond to her own goals as a learner. And there she was studying the verbs to be and to have, even before she knew any words in the vocabulary. So this is 1967 in literature. And now, in the present year, 2017, when we discuss with students and teachers, student teachers, about what they see in schools or what they teach when they have a chance to teach as part of their coursework or their activities as student teachers, they teach the verb to be and they teach haves and they teach vocabulary lists and they continue with the same practices that we have been criticizing for so many years. And they read the theories, they have access to that content. But what happens that when they have to make a decision on what to teach, what to do, they decide, yes, the students didn't know anything, and I had to start from verb to be again. Os alunos têm experiências mais variadas com o ensino de línguas em cursos de idiomas, na própria aprendizagem, viagens internacionais, e quando é a vez deles darem aula, olham seus estudantes nas escolas e definem. Temos que começar pelo verbo to be, eles não sabem nada. So what's going on? O que, é que está acontecendo? So again, here we are with a new reform, a new way of starting over, producing new knowledge, creating and implementing new practices, and we have BNCC. And one thing that probably my colleagues from the United States and Canada can bring is a perspective what the standardization of teaching has done to education in other countries. And this is where our conversation maybe start. It's because we see from a very neoliberal perspective of education, we have all these foundations, this is just an example, Lehman Foundation, that are taking responsibility for not only defining the standards of the skills and the tests that our students need to take, but also many of these foundations are now, for instance, in the United States, starting to create their own teacher education programs. And these teacher education programs are not so focused on the understanding of literacies, of teaching for social justice, for equity. They'll be part of the intertexts or the conversation is about the goals, the assessment, and probably Professor Bloom, I was trying to read about the Common Core in the United States, and I've read a lot about math problems and Common Core, all the memes, all the jokes, and the serious conversations about students learn a lot, but they fail because of the standardized tests. And are the students or language learners continue to fail here or continue not learning because of all these perspectives of when the standards become the curriculum? And in terms of foreign language, it's very important to situate language education as part of a global market. There is this industry of testings. I've never taken. I really am a survivor because I am here speaking English to you, and this way, without having any of those famous certificates that some in my generation, when I was a college student, if you didn't attend Cultura Inglesa, like you didn't get a certificate from British Council. If you hadn't been a member of Rotary and studied abroad or Partners of America, you were nothing, basically. You were just, okay, all right. Yes, you were studying letters, but you didn't live abroad, you have no. This was the situation. I'm giving a hard time for the translators with my hesitations. In another concept that I'd like to discuss with my colleagues is this of teacherpreneur. Are you familiar with this idea of teacherpreneurs? Yes, I've seen that. I'm trying to understand some of the literacy practices of youth, and that led me to understand cultures on YouTube, and the cultures of teachers, and I found teachers that are YouTubers. I was happy to see I could find videos of different classrooms around the world, teachers talking about the experience of teaching, and teachers participating in communities of teachers through YouTube. And more than that, I've learned about the existence of a Teacher Pay Teachers store, where teachers create and upload teaching materials in a website, and you can buy materials from other teachers. And I was discussing that with a colleague in the United States, and she told me that with the standards and all the testings, and the textbooks have not been good enough for teachers, and there is a moment of a boom of teachers creating their own materials and selling and buying materials from each other, which reminds me of a practice when I was a child going to school. My teacher would ask me to go to another teacher's classroom to borrow her stencil so that she could make copies for us. And nowadays, there is another sophisticated way of doing that. So there are open resources for teachers to download materials, but there are teachers that see themselves as entrepreneurs, and they are creating, selling materials, opening Amazon stores. They have YouTube channels. They have blogs. Everything. They are branding. They have a brand. Everything in order to participate in this community of not only in the sense that Barry Bird and Ryder, the authors I quote here, but there is a good side on that. However, we need as Brazilians that sometimes we, as we say in Portuguese, excuse me, pegamos o bonde andando, we need to pay attention to that, because this might be the next movement that our teachers will be engaging in and being entrepreneurs. And leadership is important. I think I have a few minutes to conclude. So teachers as leaders is very important, but we see the constructions of discourses about leaderships as part of this competition among teachers, who is more successful in the endeavor of teaching, who's more successful in branding themselves, and investing more on these ideas of being neoliberal ideas of success, professional success, than of education as we understand it when we are critical scholars. So to conclude, I've used the word intentionality, and that's because I wanted to say, yes, we know a lot. We've written, discussed, participated in lots of events together, and we have examples of good practices. However, students and student teachers continue participating in a phenomenon that is language education is not so successful in school as we expected it to be. And it's a new moment for us to seize the opportunities of recreating our practices and understanding of the role of foreign languages education and literacies. And Ana Paula Duboc, a colleague from São Paulo, calls it brechas that we need to use. There are also the expression small spaces by Brian Morgan, or in Minas Gerais, comer pelas beiradas. But we have another moment to start over, or to really intentionally setting an agenda and to overcome or to participate in this discussions of the standards, testing, entrepreneurship, neoliberalism, with more awareness and also the intentionality of what we are doing. We can't be, it's another moment for us to get together as a community of teacher educators and critical educators. Thank you.
Thank you, Miriam, for your very inspiring talk. So we have a few minutes for questions and comments from the audience. How much do you it was Okay, so we have about half an hour for comments and questions from the audience. Any questions or comments? One question over there.
Eu queria fazer uma pergunta para a Miriam. Eu, como professor de inglês, e passado por todas essas experiências, eu também aprendi com método de repetição, tive aqui na faculdade de letras, e eu me vejo também como professor repetindo a mesma coisa que você falou. E por que você acha que isso acontece? Quais as mudanças necessárias? Porque se temos acesso, se temos experiências diferentes, por que que a gente continua nessa mesma realidade? Eu vejo assim, para mim, às vezes, eu acho que pela diversidade da sala de aula, é muito fácil, por todo o contexto que o professor vive no Brasil, ensinar o verbo to be, assim, e começar por ele. Mas eu queria ver uma... E qual o caminho de saída disso se tem...
Bom, eu diria que todos os textos que eu mencionei, e tem uma vasta literatura nos falando o que tem acontecido. Eu não vou exatamente dizer, porque a gente sabe que é ideológico, mas eu, neste momento, especialmente depois dos anos que o Brasil tem vivido, em termos de política, em termos de uma série de questões que nos atingiram como educadores críticos, quando eu, pelo menos, tive momentos de perder a esperança, e eu estou agora em um momento de recuperar a esperança e tentar parar e pensar. O que estamos fazendo, a oportunidade está posta com mais uma reforma. E a gente tem que saber sentar, conversar, encontrar, mas saber que tem que ter a intenção de não fazer igual, porque igual já nos mostrou que não dá muito certo. Obrigada.
Desculpa, gente, eu sei que aqui na Faculdade de Educação vocês têm o costume de fazer as perguntas em bloco, de três perguntas. Como não é muito o meu costume, eu passei, mas pode ser em bloco também, se vocês preferirem. Any other question or comment? Uma Gil lá atrás, a moça de rosa.
Bom, só um comentário rapidinho. Eu tenho um amigo brasileiro que ele passou uns 3 meses este ano na Universidade de Stanford. onde a Fundação Lehman tem doado bastante dinheiro, né? É, e ele me disse que sempre tem alguns brasileiros do Ministério de Educação que vão para lá para consultar com professores, né? Mas ele foi com a ideia de estabelecer uma plataforma para professores brasileiros para compartilhar, não sei como dizer, lesson plans, planos
de aula.
Planejamento de aulas. De graça, porque o BNCC vem, os professores precisam de ajuda, de como formação e tudo isso. Ele teve essa noção, ele quis fazer isso com seu tempo lá. E alguém da Fundação Lehman disse, não, hoje em dia os professores são edupreneurs, como o seu teacherpreneur. Não, elas devem subir as lições para vender. Ou seja, para mim, essa ideia de teacherpreneur faz parte do neoliberalismo, da tentativa to privatizar o sistema educativo. É um perigo que a gente tem que também criticar um pouco, né? E temos que saber como as fundações grandes, ricos do mundo estão influindo no processo. Obrigada.
Outros comentários?
Well, I think I'd like to, eu gostaria de ouvir dos colegas sobre essa perspectiva de the teacherpreneur, the teachers pay teachers, e esse contexto dos standards e consequências, e questões em que nós já podemos antecipar ou sobre as quais nós podemos refletir juntos, sobre que caminhos estamos trilhando a partir desse novo momento na nossa política de educação. Porque é isso mesmo. E, olha, o Brasil tem um programa maravilhoso de distribuição de livros didáticos para as escolas públicas, que, recentemente, há um decreto, né, uma reforma em termos de como os materiais serão avaliados, mas nós tínhamos espaços para uma produção. Eu encontrei para essa apresentação, mas eu não usei, uma manchete. Livros de história ensinam que Lula salvou a economia brasileira. E tem uma charge de um super Lula. E os movimentos também da escola sem partido, que estão justamente nos distanciando do que nós mais queremos nos aproximar, temos partido, sim. E talvez os nossos colegas queiram falar um pouquinho também no debate.
Well, there's many aspects of the last question and your comments that are occurring not only in Brazil, but they're happening in Canada, and they're very concerning. Of teacherpreneurship, edupreneurs. At one level, there's certainly this concern of seeing education and knowledge as a commodity to be sold. Another thing that concerns me is again, this idea of neoliberal pressures, the retreat of, or the putting of more responsibilities onto teachers to achieve maybe goals that should not be theirs alone. So there's the danger of people who have a partnership role retreating from those responsibilities. Which I think is the larger question you see of neoliberalism, of governments, researchers, saying now that it's the job of the teacher as the teacher entrepreneur to take more initiative and responsibility or sole responsibility for education achievement. So that's one dimension that's quite frightening. And maybe the other one that's happening, which is the flip side of this. So there's two sides of this kind of new economic model. The one of making teachers solely responsible, but then there's the other problem of remaking or convincing the public that teaching is something that is no to deprofessionalize. I don't know how that translates, but yeah. And so the other thing that concerns me is something that is also happening under the same umbrella of a more economic instrumental model. Ken Zeichner once talked about something that happened in the States called good enough teachers. So, and maybe it's decided the same thing, that to be a teacher is, on the one hand, very easy to being a producer of boxed products in a factory. That, on the other hand, we don't need to invest or spend the time necessary to be a teacher who can think, respond in ways that are locally responsive. So this idea of deprofessionalizing is part of, is almost two sides of the same neoliberal coin, in my sense. And there are very serious problems that require us to try to resist them in micro ways and organize them with colleagues and other stakeholders.
Muito obrigada aos professores pelas contribuições que nos deram. Eu estou meio preocupada, assim, estou pensando na pergunta do professor de inglês. Como é que você chama? Marcos, a pergunta do Marcos. Porque ele faz uma pergunta que, de fato, os dois professores que falaram anteriormente, a Miriam, né, tanto o Brian quanto o David, eles e a Miriam levanta questões, eles apontam várias questões que a gente pode pensar, como a gente pode mudar a nossa prática. Né? Eu quero ressaltar duas coisas. Quando o Brian diz, texts is a mirror for students. Texts is a mirror for students. E ele faz a relação entre identidade, cultura, linguagem, cultura e identidade. Né? Isso é uma coisa muito importante. Como que nós trazemos a vida, as pessoas de carne e osso para dentro da sala de aula? Como que a gente pode pensar o ensino de inglês, de história, de geografia, de o que for, né? Com as pessoas concretas com as quais a gente lida? E o David, ele fala uma coisa muito importante, ou seja, o que nós estamos ensinando, reading comprehension, não é só it's not a skills, it's a human activity. Então, isso, eu acho que essas coisas, né, essas duas coisas, elas têm que chamar, a gente precisa de chamar atenção para as nossas, elas devem estar fazendo elas devem estar presentes nas nossas práticas, né? Dentro de sala de aula, fora da sala de aula, porque é muito mais importante a gente pensar no ensino-aprendizagem como uma atividade humana, mais do que como aquisição de habilidades individuais de leitura, escrita, né? Ou matemática, ou o que for, né? Mas como nós podemos pensar o ensino de inglês, por exemplo, como uma atividade humana. Obrigada.
Algum outro comentário? Pergunta?
Meu nome é Romina. I'll try to speak in English, but as we were discussing, I was thinking in my situation, I was working in Portugal, and I think it could be useful so I can share the experience of what happened in a national curriculum problem in Portuguese language. So they changed the curriculum in 2013 to a very, let's say, quantitative approach. So, for example, for the first year in the first grade, they define how many words and how many times the student should read at the end of the year, and then in the second, in the third, and in the fourth year. They also dismissed some very important heritage of literature in the national curriculum. So what happened? It was useful in terms of quantifying and for the numbers. So in that sense, it was very ideological. And the curriculum start. It still is in use. So in the practice, so the curriculum had they put. The main point is to teach contents and not processes. And now, and then it starts a whole problem that it goes until the students get into university, and when they get in the university, the teachers in the academia can work with processes because they have 12 years of working with content and not reading, comprehension, interpretation of the text, what is the meaning of the text in this context, and is it different in another one. So now, the new and recent government, it's a coalition of three left parties, is trying to change this, which causes and brings also different problems. So in the next year, it will start a more flexible curriculum. So in some schools, like there are pilot schools, pilot studies, pilot projects, they will try to implement some flexibility inside the classes. So the teacher will be able to choose, I suppose, how he or she will teach the reading comprehension and the reading comprehension methods and all that. But then the problem is, and this is my point, the kind of training those teachers in the middle school and the high school and the first years have in the university. And so I think the problem is, I was thinking that we were discussing a lot about high school and medium and kindergarten, because it also starts in the kindergarten with emergent literacy, but then the problem goes until the university. So I would like just to put this point on the university, the training of that we give to the students in the graduation, because I think also the problem is also there. Thank you.
I don't know what to say in response to that.
Maybe your first idea to have two questions.
Okay, three other questions.
I'm Lori Katz, and I speak from the United States and in teacher education. And there's a couple of things. One is I want to build off what Mafa was talking about in terms of humanizing. We really need to teach our teachers how to get to know their students and how to really form relationships with their students. If you don't do that, you're not teaching. You have to really get to know where they're coming from, how to understand the cultural resources, the strengths that they bring, and then build on those in terms of your lessons. The other thing I find is that the core curriculum in the United States is that there's a big misunderstanding in terms of the core curriculum. A lot of teachers in the United States teach only how they interpret the core curriculum. It's a roadmap. It's literally a roadmap. And it doesn't mean you can't teach other things, you know, that you think are important. And I think what happens, it comes very much down to skill-based kind of teaching. And we have to get back to how kids learn. They learn through situated learning, activities, what's important to them in the classroom. I think that's really critical. The other point I want to make, since I teach inclusion education in the United States. No one lesson plan meets the needs of all your students. You have to learn, and that's another reason for getting back to the humanizing. You have to know everything about your 30, 20 some odd, how many students you have in your classroom. You have to know their ability levels, their ethnicities, their linguistic, their backgrounds, their interests, so you can really build on that. And also, so you can really know how to adapt a lesson. It's one thing to get a lesson from wherever. But it's another thing to adapt that to really meet the needs of your students, because whatever you teach, if you only teach one thing, you're only meeting the needs of a very, really your average kids, and that's it.
Muito obrigada por essa mesa redonda tão interessante e essas três apresentações que eu gostei muito. Uma coisa me chamou a atenção na apresentação da última oradora, não sei se posso dizer assim, Miriam.
Miriam.
Quando você falou dessas conversações efervescentes, entendi, se entendi bem, o papel importante das, o que em francês chamaríamos representações coletivas, não? Os discursos políticos sobre o ato de ensinar e de aprender, e pode ser de adquirir linguagens. E, eu pensei nisso, não? Os exemplos que você deu. Não é necessário para as crianças brasileiras saber inglês, porque nunca vão viajar. Essa imagem tão instrumental das línguas. E isso me chamou a atenção, porque me ajuda a fazer um paralelo com a situação em Europa, de onde eu sou. E nos anos 90 foi um período muito rico para o campo de ensinança e aprendizagem de línguas estrangeiras, que corresponde a uma construção de um ideal europeu, que vamos viajar em cada país, vamos ser uma comunidade, e vai ser muito importante o papel dos idiomas. Isso estava um discurso dominante, mas escondendo também um pouco os interesses econômicos, ok? Se vamos ensinar francês no Portugal, se ensinamos português na França, ok, mas então em Portugal vocês têm que ensinar francês também, né? Coisas assim. Mas agora parece que eu tenho a impressão que essa época bençoada para a aprendizagem de línguas está um pouco caindo, não? E, ao mesmo vez, eu vejo que na Europa estão levando nacionalismos, retratações, o Brexit, a ameaça do Frexit. Não sei se vocês são familiares com esses problemas, mitos que temos na Europa, não? E então eu pensava nisso, o papel importante dos discursos políticos e ambientes no ar sobre o interesse para os jovens de aprender linguagens adicionais e de suceder, de reussir nessa aprendizagem. Muito obrigada por ajudar-me a pensar isso. Hein?
Boa tarde, mesa. Boa tarde, colegas. Eu quero falar de um lugar que eu gosto muito, mas que me angustia também, que é o chão da escola, a sala de aula. Eu sou professora da educação básica, estou fazendo doutorado agora em educação no Rio de Janeiro, mas eu não dou aula de nenhuma língua, né? Mas eu estou no campo, na área de linguagens, que eu sou professora de teatro, de artes. Na escola, e sou também aquela professora normalista, que é dos anos iniciais. Não é? E são tantas coisas que me angustiam. Eu vou tentar falar assim, de cada uma delas em tópicos, mas sem necessariamente construir uma relação assim. É uma tempestade mesmo para a gente refletir.
É, a primeira delas é com relação a adaptar, né, que a professora deu o exemplo dos Estados Unidos, a adaptar o núcleo comum, a base nacional comum, né, aqui vai ser chamada base nacional, lá ela falou núcleo, mas me parece bem parecido. É, essa coisa da adaptação é uma coisa que fica um hiato, fica uma angústia, porque a gente observando lá a escrita da BNCC, ela vem toda codificada, né, com códigos alfanuméricos, que ali é uma espécie de controle mesmo para saber o que o professor está ensinando em sala de aula. Eu digo isso porque a gente teve uma experiência, a gente tem, aliás, uma experiência que é uma, entre aspas, vanguarda, assim, né? Um horror, que é na rede estadual do Rio de Janeiro, que a gente é monitorado pelo que se lança numa plataforma online. Então, tem esse vínculo de controle. Então, a gente aqui discutindo a mesa, né, sobre empoderamento, né, através das linguagens, pensar sobre a BNCC, e principalmente com o dado, né, que a professora trouxe, que esse termo letramento foi retirado, é muito doloroso, porque eu, particularmente, eu tive contato inicialmente com essa discussão sobre letramento lá, na escola. Não foi na faculdade. Depois, quando eu cheguei à faculdade, foi que eu tive esse contato. E como foi que me chegou? Através dos livros didáticos, né? Letramento e alfabetização, aqueles livros que foram, né, entregues para os professores. Foi através dali que eu tive o primeiro contato. E aí, se o documento oficial não respalda, e o novo programa, o PNLD, teve mudanças, né, tá sendo reconfigurado, então como é que isso vai chegar? Vou esperar até a faculdade para ter um contato com esse conhecimento que transforma, com essa metodologia que ajuda a gente a se empoderar? É muito conflituoso, porque assim, o professor, pelo pouco tempo que tem, pela precarização do trabalho, fica praticamente obrigado a estar reproduzindo o que está ali naquela base. E outra coisa que me angustia assim, é que a gente fica só falando do inglês, né, e o espanhol, né? Tantos países vizinhos nossos aqui, né, falam espanhol, e o espanhol foi retirado. Também queria pontuar que tem uma fundação, eu não estou lembrada qual é a fundação, me mandaram o link, mas eu não sei se é Abril, se é Editora Abril, não sei quem é, mas que já está cadastrando professores para serem selecionados para elaborarem planos de aula, para ser replicado. Então, assim, a gente vem todo animado para um colóquio, né, debate, empoderamento, debate como fazer um trabalho mais significativo que não seja reprodutivo na sala de aula, mas lá o documento oficial, as diretrizes, não dá respaldo nenhum. Aqui não é uma assembleia, aqui não é essa instância. Mas eu fico pensando, assim, você mostrou aí uma citação do texto da AMPED, né? Aí, tem tantos pesquisadores aqui da área de letramento, de tantas universidades, a gente não poderia, sei lá, sair com uma moção, uma página no Facebook, alguma coisa que denunciasse isso, que falasse isso, que levasse essa reflexão para o conjunto de professores, para não ficar só entre a gente aqui na academia. É isso.
Hi. Boa tarde.
Boa tarde.
Figured we'd been quiet very long. But in my 5 decades of teaching, every decade in the United States, we have reformed. So I want to raise a question that seems to permeate those 5 decades. And it seems that at the end of the 60s, there was an artificial separation of learning from instruction, not just teaching. And what we mean by teaching, maybe it's time to rethink what that concept means. Because the arbitrary separation of theory from method and research happened in 1977 in anthropology. Actually, 25 years earlier, according to Bateson, Gregory Bateson, the anthropologist. So what we've been going through, if I see and reflect on what people are demanding, in California, we used to have child development theories and learning theories guiding our standards. In the early 90s, the standards were now defined as guiding those theories of development and learning. So where is learning in the kinds of context? I think David raised some of that. I think people raised, Ryan raised some of that for teachers. Miriam raised some of that again. But the rhetorics we're using are the rhetorics of the power. Mm-hmm. And Paulo Freire, when he came to Santa Barbara, said, if we take up these rhetorics, we will reinvent victimization. So I'm wondering what the new rhetorics might look like if we came together to bring learning and instruction together again, and what constitutes the acts of teaching, learning, in a policy context. I'll show you some of that in my talk later. After 10 years in one classroom, the studies of the policy impact. So think about how we might think about this in new ways to rethink it. We were asked to do that in the United States in 1961. We still haven't done it.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments? No questions?
In listening to the comments people make, my thinking was, yes, but. First, no one can tell anyone else what constitutes courage in their classroom versus what constitutes foolishness. You know, in one person's classroom in one school, doing something might be just a matter of courage. In another person's classroom in another school, doing that same thing might be foolishness because you'll get laid off or fired. No one can tell someone else. So we must each think for ourselves and we must each act. Maybe with colleagues there, but basically, I don't think anyone can tell anyone else exactly what to do that way. The second is, I worry that we are looking often for a kinder and gentler way to do the same thing that we are being asked to do in a not so gentle and kinder way. I think that one of the projects we need to be about, and we do not need to wait till we're at the university, is to deconstruct and problematize all of the very basic concepts we think we know in education. We need to deconstruct, what do we mean by achievement? What do we mean by learning? Not which is the better way to learn, but what do we actually mean by this term? How are we using it to do what with? The same with teaching. The same with what it means to be a student. The same with what it means to know our students. We need to actually think, what does that really mean? And why do we think that's important? Is it important just to get our students to the same place that we would have wanted to get them without knowing them? I mean, is it just a kinder, gentler, more efficient way to get them to the same place? I worry greatly about this for many of the reasons that you have already stated. Education is, at least in the United States, is very much embedded in an ideology of exchange value. That is, you go to school to get something that you can then later exchange for economic mobility, economic so forth and so on, status, capital, and so forth. Once we start thinking about education in terms of exchange value, instead of the inherent value of particular things and of people themselves, which Malfa mentioned in terms of what it might mean to humanize education, once we reduce things to exchange value, we not only nominalize education, we nominalize our students, and we nominalize ourselves. It is a form of alienation that runs extraordinarily deep. And I think we need to think about this. I think we need to ask ourselves, because we feel it. We feel it when we go home at the end of the day of teaching and learning, and we ask ourselves, what actually happened in class in school today? Why do I feel so empty, as so many people will do? Why do I feel so much joy at having students having accomplished a particular test score when I know it will not change their lives or the lives of many? We need to think about these things. And then we need to ask ourselves, in the situation we are in, what might we do? How might we act on those reflections? Which will not be the same for everybody because our situations are different. So, yes, but.
There's not much more to add to that. That was really great, David. I guess one of the related, just the other aspect of this is going back to Miriam was mentioning these small spaces for teaching. One of the problems I find with teachers is that we've kind of internalized a notion of learning as predicted at the beginning of the lesson, demonstrated at the end of the lesson. So the comment about, if I was thinking about one of the small things we can do in our class is be open to learning that is, as David was saying earlier, nonlinear learning that's recursive. The idea of Bateson's work was just mentioned. Being able to be aware that what are the assumptions that we've internalized, the ideologies of learning, and be open to lessons that the lesson itself is a meta lesson, something that will be learned much later, and that see beyond the instrumental test score. I'll give you an interesting analogy, or an experience of this was related to the old TOEFL tests. And talking about shifts in knowledge of what it means to know a language, the TOEFL tests, which everyone had to write to get to go to a university in North America, they were multiple choice, discrete grammar items. And then for years and years and years, we'd find students at my university that got 90s on these tests, passed them brilliantly. They couldn't function in a classroom. So we had to rethink the knowledge of what does it mean, what are the ideologies at this time, what are the intertextual social assumptions of what it means to know. And those tests, they still have problems, but they came much more intertextual, interactive. They required students to do things, make meanings, think synergistically, all sorts of things. So, I mean, there's small steps of progress, there's new pressures, but it's astounding how we go through these cycles of seeing new small places to as teacher educators, to see our problems or our biases and look for ways in which we can open up other possibilities.
Eu gostaria de comentar que eu disse inicialmente que eu queria a conversa, e a conversa aconteceu. E eu vejo muito mais como um momento para ser marcado pela esperança da mudança, da transformação, do que um momento de uma crítica e em termos de nos conformarmos com todos esses movimentos que afetam. Eu vejo um lugar extremamente importante para o formador de professores e até de construção de uma formação não tão fragmentada, que não dialoga com o que nós consideramos importante como transdisciplinaridade, como colaboração, como essa perspectiva da escola, né, do professor, chão de fábrica. E eu fiquei imaginando se eu falei algo que desesperançava, então eu queria mesmo era dizer que não, eu quero falar do lugar da esperança, porque muito nós já fizemos e muitas transformações já foram vistas, mas estamos no furacão novamente de mais uma reforma, então é mais um momento. E eu gosto muito do comentário do David sobre nós pararmos para pensar e problematizar cada conceito, cada palavra que nós usamos ao falar de educação, porque nós podemos estar falando coisas muito diferentes ou as mesmas coisas e ter os e na verdade com compreensões. No caso da BNCC, do inglês, eu recomendo que a leitura dos pareceres dos leitores críticos. Há alguns interessantes que apontam, por exemplo, Círio Pocente, que aponta que, se não tivermos certas condições, nós vamos fazer com esse documento o que aconteceu com os PCNs, interpretações lineares, em que os standards se tocam, né, se tornam mais importantes que os processos, não é o que nós queremos. Há também interpretações de itens codificados em que nos levam ou fazer mais do mesmo ou reinventar a partir da nova linguagem que nós temos para falar sobre ensino. Então, eu posso entender, falar quem eu sou como mais uma oportunidade de falar, ensinar o verbo to be, uma lista de vocabulário de profissões, ou eu posso dizer quem eu sou numa perspectiva de que lugares sociais eu ocupo, de aspectos da minha identidade que são relevantes e como eu quero ser participante da vida dessa escola, nesses processos. Então, para mim, é um momento bom, é um momento de recomeço, mas sempre no sentido transformador.
So, if we don't have any other questions or comments, I think it's time to finish the session. Thank you very much, Brian, David, and Miriam, for your very inspiring talk. Só um pouquinho, gente, alguns comentários ainda, alguns announcements, okay? So, Gil is going to give you a few announcements.
Permitam dizer que, depois dessa abertura, o sentimento é que vale e valeu muito a pena esse esforço e essa parceria de todos por estarem aqui. Eu acho bastante produtivo pelo nível e pelo alto nível de questionamento que os nossos colegas nos trouxeram. Me permitam também, já que eu enveredei por um tom pessoal, de cumprimentar a nossa colega Maria Lúcia Castanheira, que está nos acompanhando nessa transmissão, e dizer a ela o quanto também estamos sentindo a presença dela aqui, e esperamos poder revê-la em breve e dar o abraço merecido pessoalmente. Né? Sentimos a sua presença, Lalu. Na nossa programação, como um evento acadêmico, a gente sabe que ele precisa ter também uma confraternização, fizemos um esforço para que nós tivéssemos também essa oportunidade de continuarmos as conversas também em outros espaços. Então, eu convido a todos para uma pequena celebração, movida muito pelo espírito local, então vocês terão um gostinho das coisas típicas aqui de Minas Gerais. E, ao mesmo tempo, também, eu gostaria de fazer um convite a vocês. Nós temos, foi tudo, vocês, por favor, levem em conta isso, nós não tivemos muito tempo de organizar como gostaríamos. Talvez nunca realizaremos um ideal também de encontro, então, nós fazemos os encontros, né? Então, não programamos muito essa questão do lançamento dos livros. Então, ela vai ser uma coisa também bastante informal, e foi também de última hora. E eu gostaria, já que o tom do nosso colóquio é de conversação, e ela envolve também relações entre poder e linguagem, não sou eu aqui que vou fazer a apresentação dos trabalhos. Eu gostaria de forma muito rápida, vocês me permitam, passar a palavra para os nossos colegas que vão lançar os livros hoje, né? Professora Mafá, a nossa colega Raquel e a nossa colega Socorro, de diferentes universidades. Então, coisa de um minutinho, pelo menos, para eu não ficar... Eu levo o microfone até aí. Então, para vocês, inclusive, conhecerem as autoras e os títulos, vocês vejam que era uma estratégia retórica de eu não falar os títulos de forma errada. Então, estou aqui passando a palavra para vocês.
Obrigada, Gil. Bom, o texto que nós estamos o livro que nós estamos lançando é um livro que foi escrito por mim, por duas alunas que foram minhas orientandas. A Maíra Tomaino de Melo Dias foi minha orientanda de mestrado, de doutorado, fez iniciação científica comigo, hoje ela já está em outro espaço. A Patrícia Guimarães Vargas, que é... Rosa demais. Que foi minha orientanda de mestrado, hoje ela é professora da rede municipal, professora de educação de jovens e adultos. Esse livro é fruto de uma pesquisa etnográfica longitudinal em que nós trabalhamos durante 3 anos em uma sala de crianças e outra sala de adultos, em que eles iniciavam o processo de alfabetização, e a gente faz contrastes entre essas duas salas durante os 3 primeiros anos de aprendizado das crianças e dos adultos. A perspectiva que a gente adota, a gente trabalha essencialmente com a perspectiva da psicologia histórico-cultural e da etnografia interacional. Nós tentamos fazer análises contrastivas, interpretativas, holísticas da sala de aula, das duas salas de aula. E o título do livro é Entre Textos e Pretextos, a produção escrita de crianças e adultos na perspectiva histórico-cultural. Eu espero que vocês gostem. Obrigada.
Publicado pela editora UFMG. Tá? Já estamos discutindo letramento acadêmico, né, que será um tópico em uma das mesas.
Bom, o livro se chama Letramentos Acadêmicos. Você não está com ele aí? Tem um subtítulo. Desculpem, mas eu não estou... lembrando exatamente as palavras. Bom, mas, na verdade, é uma coletânea de artigos que eu organizei, com artigos de ex-orientandos e outros participantes do grupo de pesquisa sobre letramentos acadêmicos lá na Unicamp, com alguns alunos de pós-doutorado, alguns pesquisadores de pós-doutorado, alunos de pós-graduação, e uma tradução de um artigo da Mary Jane Curry e a Teresa Lilles, que são duas autoras que têm nos inspirado um pouco assim, nas nossas análises. Tá? Ele foi publicado no final do ano passado. O livro é esse aqui, Letramentos Acadêmicos, Contextos, Práticas e Percepções. Tem um artigo meu, os outros são dessas pessoas, né, variadas aí que eu falei para vocês.
Raquel, muito modesta, não quis fazer uma propaganda. É o seguinte, ela trouxe poucos exemplares e ela se comprometeu a quem quiser depois enviar um e-mail para ela, já que estamos falando também de práticas de leitura e de escrita. Né? Rafa Fiad, Rafa. Tinha um F aqui, né? Acho que é melhor. Rafa Fiad@gmail.com. Isso, claro, vocês podem conversar depois com a autora, que vai dar mais detalhes sobre como conseguir.
Bom, boa noite. Eu estou com 2 livros sendo lançados. O primeiro, temos vários autores aqui, é uma coletânea de textos publicados pela editora da UFPE, resultado do congresso, do 2º Congresso Brasileiro de Alfabetização, promovido pela Associação Brasileira de Alfabetização. O título é Políticas e Práticas de Alfabetização, obviamente, em diferentes perspectivas, a alfabetização está sendo tratada. Nós temos aqui a Mônica Correia, da UFMG, que escreveu para o livro, a Patrícia Cossino, da UFRJ, também a Ludmilla. Quem mais? Se eu estiver esquecendo, acho que as 3 estão aqui. Nós temos textos de pessoas de diferentes regiões do país e também temos o texto de Elisa Cracknolindo, que é uma parceira de trabalho também no campo do letramento, da alfabetização, que é da Universidade de Córdoba, na Argentina. O 2º livro se chama Educação do Campo. é também uma coletânea organizada. O primeiro, eu esqueci de falar, foi organizado por mim e pela professora Cláudia Gontijo. Nós estávamos à frente, ainda estamos, da presidência e vice-presidência da Associação Brasileira de Alfabetização. O segundo livro foi organizado por mim, pela professora Lourdes Helena e a professora Gilvanice Musial. Lourdes Helena é da Federal de Viçosa, Gilvanice atualmente era da UENG e agora está na Universidade Federal da Bahia. E é um conjunto de textos, resultados de um projeto que levamos a cabo, essas três instituições, de pesquisa sobre a educação no campo, onde a gente discute tanto as questões de letramento no campo, principalmente letramento no contexto do MST, e das escolas família agrícolas também. Nós temos ali uma pesquisa que investigou o curso de Pedagogia da Terra, aqui da UFMG. Temos vários textos de autores que investigaram a questão da educação do campo nesses últimos 5 anos aqui no estado de Minas Gerais. Então, convido a todos a estarem presentes conosco. Obrigada, Gil, pela oportunidade.
E o último, talvez, é só para lembrar a vocês que, em função do número de trabalhos e do número de pessoas que responderam tão positivamente ao nosso chamado para esse colóquio, nós vamos ter uma intensidade, né? Então, amanhã, às 8 horas, com a mesa redonda Linguagem e Relações de Poder na Primeira Infância, então, aqui as nossas convidadas já estão aqui hoje, né? Não precisam ficar aqui, não. Podem voltar amanhã, às 8 horas. Então, é isso. Mais uma vez, um forte agradecimento. Agradecimento ao André, que conduziu os trabalhos dessa mesa. E tenhamos uma boa confraternização. Obrigado.
There's a party. I think so. I think they have music and food.
Oh, that's perfect. As long as we have something wet.
Thanks, Jill. People forgot.
Hey, Jill. Thank you for particularly what you did for Brian.